afternoon. Welcome. You're watching Good Morning India. I'm Gargi Rawat. Stay with us for all the news you need to follow this morning. Up ahead, we'll get you all the latest news on the vaccine. And it's not just the farmers who are protesting now. Doctors are protesting as well. We'll get you all those details. Let's take a look at the headlines we're tracking this morning. In the United States, the FDA advisors recommend authorization of the Pfizer-BioNTech coronavirus vaccine. Now the FDA will take a final call. While vaccines are yet to be approved for emergency use in India, authorities are getting ready for the vaccination program with priority lists being drawn up and storage plans. A nationwide doctors' strike today to protest against the government's decision to allow postgraduate Ayurvedic doctors to perform surgery. Services could be hit. It's the 16th day of the farmers' protest. No headway, with groups claiming they will intensify the protest. The agriculture minister has appealed for talks. Hitting back at the BJP's allegations, West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee has claimed the attack on party chief JP Nadda's convoy in the state was a drama staged to divert attention. A total beef ban in Karnataka after the new cow slaughter law comes into play. 7 years in jail and a 10 lakh fine. While India is waiting for a vaccine to be approved here, we are getting ready, however, for the vaccine program. From Mumbai to Delhi, storage plans are in place and priority lists of those who will get the vaccine are being readied.
A cold storage, three stories high, being built in Delhi to store COVID vaccines. From here, vaccines will be sent to 600 cold points across the city to vaccinate people. Preparation is even being made to store the Pfizer vaccine at minus 70 degrees Celsius, even though there is no plan yet to import that.
For Pfizer vaccine, we want minus 70 degrees Celsius, and similarly for other vaccines, we require 2 to 8 degrees or minus 40 or minus 20. So we are keeping all ranges of freezers.
The list is close to being finalized on who gets the shot first. Nearly 2 lakh government and private healthcare workers, according to sources. They will include doctors, nurses, sanitation workers, security and administrative staff of not just allopathic hospitals but also dental and Ayush facilities. Also, staff members of diagnostic laboratories, radiology centers and physiotherapy clinics are also being listed. From Delhi government's largest hospital, LNJP, names of nearly 4,000 staff members are on the list.
नर्स हैं, पैरामेडिक्स हैं और जो भी हमारे यहाँ पे अस्पताल में काम करते हैं, सारे कर्मचारियों की जो लिस्ट है वो हमने दिल्ली सरकार को और भारत सरकार को भेज दिए। हम पूरी तरह से तैयार हैं, जैसे ही वैक्सीन हमें उपलब्ध होगा हम उनको ये वैक्सीन लगाने की प्रक्रिया चालू करते हैं।
Mumbai has prepared a complete blueprint for its storage, transportation and distribution. In the initial phase, the municipality has selected 4 hospitals for vaccination and storage and has created a vaccine task force. The BMC has created a 10-member task force for the vaccine. Nearly 3,000 staff are being trained on how to handle the transportation of the vaccine in the vaccine box. In the initial phase, KEM, Sion, Nair and Cooper hospitals have been selected for vaccination and its collection. The current system of cold storage is under review so that necessary changes can be made. Refrigerators, ice boxes and special coolers are being ordered. An attempt is being made to build a storage capacity of 60 lakh vials of vaccine. Blood banks and drug storage can also be used if needed. Some additional corona vaccines will be transferred into a specially constructed 5-story building on Kanjur Marg and stored in cold storage.
मुंबई महानगरपालिका के 4 मेडिकल कॉलेज में उचित मात्रा में स्टोरेज फैसिलिटी उपलब्ध है, जहां पे 2 डिग्री सेल्सियस से 8 डिग्री सेल्सियस तक हम टेम्परेचर मेंटेन कर सकते हैं।
For the next phase, the state governments are also trying to work out the modalities of sending the data of those whose age is either 60 or above and those who are in the 50 to 59 age group and have comorbidities. With Pooja Bhardwaj in Mumbai and camera person Sanjay Kaushik in New Delhi, this is Sukirti Dwivedi for NDTV.
Now, doctors are going on strike today. A nationwide doctor's strike has been called for today against the government's decision to allow postgraduate Ayurvedic doctors to perform surgeries. And this may cause major disruptions in healthcare services across the country amid the COVID pandemic. The Indian Medical Association has called for a withdrawal of all non-essential and non-COVID services between 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. today. However, emergency services, including casualty, labor rooms and emergency surgeries, will be exempt from this strike along with ICU and CCU. Private hospitals across the country, however, have raised concern over the strike and are taking steps to ensure the smooth functioning of services. The IMA has indicated that the agitation may even intensify in the coming week. So what is this agitation about? Now, what the government order regarding Ayurveda has said, that postgraduate scholars of Shalya and Shalakya shall be practically trained to acquaint with as well as to independently perform 59 procedures. The procedures include hernioplasty, cataract surgery, rhinoplasty, root canal treatment. Now, why the doctors are opposing this, what the IMA has said, that one nation, one system policy will ring the death knell of modern medicine, a step in advancing and legitimizing what they've called mixopathy, can't legitimize encroachment into the jurisdiction of modern medicine, notification illegal, the Khichdi-fication of medical education and practice is what they've called it. And it's also the patient's right to choose a system of medicine being taken away. They've said it will be the poor people who will suffer if Ayurvedic doctors are allowed to perform these surgeries. So from the doctors' protest, now the latest on the farmers' protest, and it's the 16th day of the farmers' protest. Yesterday, the government offered to amend its new agricultural laws in a bid to resolve the face-off with protesters camped at Delhi's borders and appeal to farmers to end their agitation and join the next round of talks. Addressing a press conference, Union Agriculture Minister Narendra Singh Tomar said yesterday that I would still urge the unions to find a way through discussions by withdrawing their next phase of agitation. The farmers have said they will be intensifying their protests.
Kisan thand mein itni badi tadad mein yahan par baithe hue hain aur covid ka sankat bhi hai to nishchit roop se hum sab logon ke man mein bhi raat din chinta rehti hai aur isliye hum logon ki lagatar pehle bhi koshish rahi hai aur abhi bhi main aapke madhyam se किसान भाइयों और बहनों को आग्रह करना चाहता हूं कि आप सब ने चर्चा के दौरान जो प्रश्न उठाए थे उन प्रश्नों का समाधान करने के लिए लिखित प्रस्ताव भारत सरकार ने आपके समक्ष भेजा है। आप उन प्रस्ताव पर विचार करें और आपकी तरफ से जब भी चर्चा की स्थिति के लिए कहा जाएगा भारत सरकार एकदम चर्चा के लिए तैयार रहेगी। मैंने भी दोनों हाउस में इस बात को बोला और सबको आश्वस्त किया कि एमएसपी चलती रहेगी, इस पर कोई खतरा नहीं है। एमएसपी की रबी और खरीफ की जो खरीद है इस वर्ष भी बहुत अच्छे से हुई है और रबी की फसल की बुआई के समय एमएसपी घोषित कर दी है। एमएसपी को नरेंद्र मोदी जी के नेतृत्व में डेढ़ गुना किया गया है, खरीद का वॉल्यूम भी बढ़ाया गया है। पहले गेहूं और धान पर ही खरीद होती थी, अब दलहन और तिलहन पर भी खरीद की जा रही है और एमएसपी से किसानों को ज्यादा से ज्यादा सुरक्षा मिल सके और उसमें अधिक पैसा हम खर्च कर सकें। इस दृष्टि से नरेंद्र मोदी जी की सरकार की प्रतिबद्धता पहले भी थी, आज भी है और आने वाले कल में रहेगी।
And meanwhile, news coming in that two IPS officers who were leading the police force at the Shingu border, that's between Delhi and Haryana, where the farmers have been sitting in protest against the three farm laws, they've tested positive for coronavirus. A DCP and an additional DCP have also been diagnosed with the disease. That's what the Delhi police have said. Both are under medical observation. Remember, this has been a big concern with such a huge gathering in place. And we've seen when the farmers are protesting, not everybody is wearing masks or even observing any sort of distancing. So coronavirus, they're moving through that crowd, and the policeman also testing positive for coronavirus. And while it's very, very cold, many farmers have also died due to the cold. In fact, there's a list now of the farmers who've died. At least 11 farmers are said to have died due to the cold there during the protest. Delhi has become colder and colder in the north, and it's foggy as well in the morning. So a real risk to the farmers who've been protesting. So today, it It's the 16th day of protest. So far, the government has clamped down on the issue of the minimum support price, saying that they will give it in writing. But the outreach has failed and the deadlock is continuing.
...200 kilometers from Delhi's borders, where thousands of farmers have occupied multiple roads in protest against the government's new agriculture laws. In Punjab's Sangrur, these women from farmer families are knitting sweaters that will be sent to protesters who have been living in the open despite Delhi's harsh winter.
ਚਾਹੁੰਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਵੀ ਉੱਥੇ ਕਿਸੇ ਨੂੰ ਪਰੇਸ਼ਾਨੀ ਨਾ ਆਵੇ ਜਦੋਂ ਉਹ 10-15 ਦਿਨਾਂ ਪਿੱਛੋਂ ਉਰੇ ਆਉਂਦੇ ਨੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਸਮਾਨ ਤਿਆਰ ਕਰਕੇ ਰੱਖਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਬੂਟ ਜਰਾਬਾਂ ਕੋਟ ਸਾਰਾ ਬੁਣ ਕੇ ਵੀ ਜਵਾਕ ਨੇ ਸਾਡੇ ਗਏ ਹੋਏ ਨੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਕੋਈ ਪਰੇਸ਼ਾਨੀ ਨਾ ਆਵੇ
ਫੋਰ ਇੰਡੀਆਜ਼ ਫਾਰਮਰਸ ਮੋਰ ਹੈਲਪ ਪੋਰਿੰਗ ਇਨ ਐਜ਼ ਦੇਅਰ ਪ੍ਰੋਟੈਸਟ ਇੰਟੈਂਸੀਫਾਈਜ਼ ਐਟ ਦਿੱਲੀ ਸਿੰਘੂ ਬਾਰਡਰ ਫ੍ਰੀ ਲਾਂਡਰੀ ਸਰਵਿਸ managed by these high-profile Kabaddi players, including former India captain Mani Singh Bagga.
Sarhad pe kisano ke gaons ke log hi jate hain, khelne bhi gaon ke log jate hain. To isliye is government ko bhi chahiye ke kisano ka dard samjhna chahiye.
With no conclusion from multiple meetings, it's a cold war between the government and farmers. It's these efforts that are keeping the surroundings warm and cozy. Quite literally, by Khalsa Aid, which has come up with this night shelter that can accommodate up to 400 farmers.
ये जो पार्टीशन किया हुआ है ये लेडीज के लिए हमने रखा हुआ है जो बुजुर्ग लेडीज आ रही हैं या आ रहे हैं बाहर से है ना उनके लिए हमारी प्रायोरिटी है अगर वो नहीं आते तो हम दूसरों को देते हैं
3 weeks after their protest started farmers have better food and accommodation on the road but this has taken several sacrifices and their struggles aren't all over just yet With camera persons Siddesh and Azam, in Punjab Muhammad Ghazali, and in Delhi Saurabh Shukla, this is Arun Singh for NDTV.
And Union Minister Rao Saheb Dhanwe caused quite a controversy when he claimed that China and Pakistan were behind the ongoing protest by farmers who are seeking a repeal of the three new laws. He also alleged that Muslims were earlier misled over the Citizenship Amendment Act and the National Register of Citizens. But as those efforts didn't succeed, now farmers were being told that they will face losses due to the new laws.
या देशामध्ये पहिल्यांदा मुस्लिम समाजानं उठवलं काय सांगितलं एनआरसी आली सीए आली सामान्य सगळ्या मुसलमान बाहेर जावं लागेल दाखवितलं एखादा मुसलमान बाहेर गेला तो त्यांना मात्र हे सक्सेस होत नाही
अगर केंद्र का एक मंत्री इस प्रकार से जानकारी उनके पक्ष है देता है कि ये जो आंदोलन चल रहा है उनके पीछे पाकिस्तान और चीन है तो रक्षा मंत्री राजनाथ सिंह ने तुरंत पाकिस्तान और चीन के ऊपर सर्जिकल स्ट्राइक करना चाहिए
Nadeep Sidhu, a Punjabi actor who stood with the farmers for 2 months while the protests were on in Punjab, joined the Dilli Chalo march as well. But he's not been seen at the center stage after those protests grew. And this while he made some pro-Khalistani comments that had become very controversial. Arun Singh had this chat with him at the border.
Deep Sidhu, one popular name which was always there with the farmers and all of a sudden vanished. Hi Deep. So you've been leading the farmers' protest. We spoke near Sonipat border as well. But then when you came here in Delhi, all of a sudden you disappeared. Where did you go?
No.
And what happened?
I've been here only.
Okay.
In the meantime, what happened was that because I have, I'm very outspoken whether it comes to, you know, some words like Khalistan or, you know, because I, what I believe that let's deal with it. Let's okay. not kind of reject things and make it sound like that this is radical stuff.
Okay.
You understand? Until we won't understand and we deal with it and we have this perception, oh, look at this, this is radical, look at this, this is fanatic, you know, which is not true.
So are you saying you stand by Khalistani movement?
No, no, I am not saying that. What I'm saying is that, see, these are political issues. Political issues need consideration
okay.
and interpretations. And right interpretations. Like today in our country, you know, there is another very common phenomena, Hindu Rashtra. And if you see the settlers or the urban society, they'll be like, what is this? You know, they, okay. I mean, they feel that that's radical. Probably, see, it's people's aspiration. So what I'm saying, don't make it untouchable. Let's deal with it. And let's deal with it once and for all. When I'm taking a stand with respect to some personality or with respect to some probably philosophy, which is political ideology or something,
okay.
You know, that doesn't mean that I've become anti-national.
So did the Jathebandis, they ask you to not participate?
Yeah, they told me not to be on stage. And because they also felt that it's going probably
the other way,
which I said that, okay, if that is the case, then there is no point disturbing the whole thing. But, you know, I stand for humanity. I stand for, that wherever there is injustice, you raise your voice against that. Tomorrow, if you tell me that I'll be part of the mainstream politics, okay. I won't be. Either you struggle politically or socially. You build
your path
a civil
is social.
Structure. Yeah, my
okay.
path is social.
Okay.
To build a civil structure and struggle for it means raise your voice,
okay.
You know, for it.
Welcome back. News from Delhi. And the Aam Aadmi Party has claimed that Deputy Chief Minister Manish Sisodia's residence had been attacked by BJP goons, is what they've claimed, acted with the support of the police personnel who are meant to ensure the safety and security of Mr. Sisodia and his family. Shocking visuals from videos posted online by Mr. Sisodia and AAP leaders Atishi and Raghav Chadda showed dozens of men marching up to the Deputy Chief Minister's residence and then forcing their way past a handful of policemen, at least one of whom had what looked like an assault rifle.
एक ऐसे समय पर जब उप मुख्यमंत्री का शेड्यूल उन्हें सचिवालय में दिखा रहा है उस समय पर भारतीय जनता पार्टी के गुंडे भेजे जाते हैं उस समय पर दिल्ली पुलिस को इंस्ट्रक्शन दिया जाता है कि बैरिकेड हटा दिए जाए उस समय पर दिल्ली पुलिस को इंस्ट्रक्शन दिया जाता है कि इन गुंडों को घर के अंदर घुसने दिया जाए कौन है जो भारतीय जनता पार्टी के गुंडों को इंस्ट्रक्शन देता है और दिल्ली पुलिस को भी इंस्ट्रक्शन देता है एक ही व्यक्ति है और वो है इस देश के गृहमंत्री अमित शाह
In other news, NGO HelpAge India received the 2020 UN Population Award in the institutional category for its contribution towards serving disadvantaged elderly people and raising awareness for their cause. Incidentally, December 10th is also Human Rights Day. Kiran Karnik, chairperson of HelpAge India, had said on the announcement of the award last month that it has been a long and fulfilling journey for HelpAge India. And this recognition by the UN has not only made us proud, but inspired and motivated us to continue doing what we know best. And the much coveted award consists of a gold medal, a diploma, and monetary prize.
Namaste, greetings. It is my honor.
With that, time for us to slip into a short break. Coming up on the other side, yesterday, the groundbreaking ceremony for a new parliament building. Back, a massive controversy broke out after stones were hurled at BJP chief JP Nadda's convoy in Bengal yesterday. Several ministers spoke out against this and Home Minister Amit Shah has ordered a probe. But West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee has claimed the attack on Nadda's convoy was a drama staged to divert attention from the lack of people turning up at his rally.
Dramatic pictures of the shocking attack on Mr. J.P. Nadda's cavalcade. Huge stones thrown at one vehicle after another, smashing windscreens. Top leaders Kailash Vijayvargiya and Mukul Roy suffered injuries. the BJP leaders were heading to Diamond Harbour, 65 kilometers south of Kolkata, when stones and lathis rained down. BJP workers on bikes in the convoy tracked Mr. Nadda, said Jungle Raj.
मैं यहाँ पहुंचा हूँ तो माँ दुर्गा की कृपा से पहुंचा हूँ। मैं तो आज इसलिए सुरक्षित हूँ क्योंकि मेरे पास बुलेटप्रूफ गाड़ी, अन्यथा किसी कोई गाड़ी नहीं छूटी जिस पर अटैक नहीं हुआ है। ये गुंडा राज जो हमें देखने को मिला है, इसको नेस्तनाबूद करना है।
The Home Minister has ordered a probe into the security labs. Mamata Banerjee said there will be a police probe, but wondered if there was provocation or even a conspiracy. She also said the BJP had not asked for security for Mr. Nadda from the state.
তোমরা তো স্টেটকে না জানিয়ে কত লোককে সিকিউরিটি দিয়েছি। I challenge this. তোমরা স্টেট গভর্নমেন্টকে জানাবার প্রয়োজন মনে করো না। প্রবলেম হলে তখন স্টেটকে গালাগালি দাও, কে কাকে থ্রো করেছে না প্ল্যানিং করে করেছো। যেমন ঈশ্বরচন্দ্র বিদ্যাসাগর একটা প্ল্যানিং করে করেছিলে, আমি পুলিশকে বলেছি টোটাল এনকোয়ারি করতে, এনকোয়ারি করে দেখতে। তার কারণ সব মিথ্যে সহ্য করব না।
Diamond Harbour, where the attack took place, is the constituency of Trinamool MP Abhishek Banerjee. He told a rally at Hooghly, what can we do if people don't like the BJP?
এই কালচার বাংলার মানুষ মেনে নেবে না। কোথায় কোথায় আবার বলছে আমরা নাকি গুন্ডামি করছি। আজকে বিজেপির জেপি নাড্ডা এসে ডায়মন্ড হারবারে গিয়ে গাড্ডায় পড়েছে, তা আমি কি করতে পারি? সাধারণ মানুষের ক্ষোভের বহিঃপ্রকাশের দায়িত্ব তো আমার নয়।
The attack comes a day after state BJP chief Dilip Ghosh wrote to the Home Minister raising concerns about Mr. Nadda's security after he was shown black flags in Kolkata yesterday. Mr. Ghosh has been at the receiving end of such attacks, most recently at Alipurduar and Murshidabad. But when Z Plus security is breached, it can no longer be dismissed as political skirmishing. With Jiri Shankar, Monideepa Banerjee, NDTV.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi performed the groundbreaking ceremony for the new Parliament building in the heart of Delhi on Thursday, and he said the new Parliament building will be a testament to self-reliant India. The plans are to complete the building by 2022 Independence Day, but currently it's on hold as there is a case in the Supreme Court.
भारत दुनिया का सबसे बड़ा लोकतंत्र,
द ग्राउंड ब्रेकिंग फॉर व्हाट हैज बीन कॉल्ड द आत्मनिर्भर पार्लियामेंट हाउस, led by chants by priests from the Sringeri Math in Karnataka as the Prime Minister Narendra Modi performed rituals. Priests from other religious faith also offered prayers to emphasize the multi-faith nature of the event. Protocol ensured that the President and Vice President kept away to allow the Prime Minister to take center stage.
Alag alag vichar, alag alag drashtikon, ye sab baatein एक वाइब्रेंट डेमोक्रेसी को सशक्त करते हैं। डिफरेंसेस के लिए हमेशा जगह हो, लेकिन डिस्कनेक्ट कभी ना हो, इसी लक्ष्य को लेकर हमारा लोकतंत्र आगे बढ़ा है।
मिसिंग दो वर की ऑपोजिशन लीडर्स एंड इंडिकेशन ऑफ द कंट्रोवर्सी दैट सराउंड्स द प्रोजेक्ट। इंस्टेड द कांग्रेस जयराम रमेश ट्वीटेड पॉइंटिंग आउट दैट द न्यू आत्मनिर्भर स्ट्रक्चर resembles the Pentagon building in the United States. Randeep Surjewala questioned the timings of the inauguration as farmers continued to sit in protest at the Delhi border.
The inauguration project got a go-ahead after the Supreme Court came out with a caveat
that there would be no construction, no tree relocation and no excavation work.
Unmindful of the final verdict, the Prime Minister unveiled his plans for a central vista and a monument to symbolize India's independence beyond India Gate.
Aaj India Gate se aage National War Memorial ne rashtriya pehchan banayi hai, वैसे ही संसद का नया भवन अपनी पहचान स्थापित करेगा. देश के लोग, आने वाली पीढ़ियां नए भवन को देखकर गर्व करेगी कि ये स्वतंत्र भारत में बना है.
रतन टाटा वॉज प्रेजेंट. द टाटास हैव गॉट द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट टू बिल्ड द न्यू स्ट्रक्चर. Expected to complete the project in just under 2 years at a cost of 971 crores. Overall, the ambitious 20,000 crore Central Vista project has been questioned as a wasteful exercise during a time of economic stress.
One of the reasons to change this majestic parliament building is that members of parliament argued that they do not have an office space despite having palatial residential houses in central Delhi. Clearly, the focus should be on them meeting their constituents in their constituency rather than in New Delhi. With camera person Ashok Mahale, Sunil Prabhu, NDTV.
And Ratan Tata was present at that ceremony yesterday. Remember, Tata Projects Limited has been given the contract for construction of the new parliament building. Here's what he had to say.
An impressive project, and I wish it all success to
it will be the milestone for Tata.
I don't know enough about the project to I'm privileged to have been invited to the foundation stone laying.
News from Karnataka now, where the controversial new Cow Protection Act, which replaces legislation from earlier, has been red flagged for provisions that many are calling undemocratic. Punishment for a first-time conviction ranges from a prison term of 3 to 7 years and fines between 50,000 and 5 lakh. A subsequent convictions could invite fines of up to 10 lakh and a jail term of up to 7 years. The sale and transfer of cattle for slaughter is also prohibited.
Karnataka's new Act for Cow Protection is much tougher than the existing 1964 Act it will replace, and key provisions are being criticized. The ban on slaughter goes beyond cows and calves to include bulls, bullocks, and male and female buffaloes below 13 years old. Their sale, purchase and transport for slaughter has also been prohibited.
The entire bill is against the farmers. They are trying to polarize. No need of polarizing.
In the interest of cultural point of view of the Indians, say when you come to Christians, when you come to Dalits, when you come to Muslims, their sentiments are being hurt.
Congress people always oppose such things. For that, I don't want to react. So I request them to come and attend the assembly.
It's Gau Mata for my Hindu friends, for my Hindu brothers. That's okay. We understand, we value sentiments. We study in such colleges where we don't used to have beef in front of our friends. Why? Because we respect them. This is the beauty of India.
Also planned for a future legislative session, the introduction of a bill against so-called love jihad. With Govindan Kumar, Maya Sharma in Bengaluru for NDTV.
Deputy Chief Minister of Karnataka, Dr. Ashwath Narayan, spoke to NDTV on the new beef ban, and he raised concerns and in startling observations by him that in Karnataka, cow vigilantes have lost lives. And he said earlier the life was at risk for the vigilantes.
Sir, the worrying aspect of your law, which is why many believe this is really political, is that you brought in a section that, as we pointed out, emboldens and gives protection to vigilantes. It says no suit prosecution shall be instituted against any persons exercising power under this act for anything in good faith.
Yeah, definitely, sir. The vigilant, whoever is working for a cause, for the law of the land, definitely they should be having a scope to work in this provision to ensure and to report, to communicate with the system wherever any of this kind of illegal activity or against the law, if it is happening, they need to communicate, they need to bring it to the notice, they have to prevent the work in the prevention.
But sir, vigilantes have attacked, as you know, and killed people in the name of the cow.
No. Because, it, see, earlier, sir, earlier, the same kind of, you know, the more aggressive, the life was at risk for the vigilantes, not for the, it was more for the cow vigilants who were working for the preservation and conservation. They were at the loss. They were at risk working in the odd hours. The people who were doing into the trade, they were completely armed. They were taking life. They were killing. They were doing everything. It is not the cow vigilants.
Sir,
it is not other way it is. It is actually other way. The people who are into the trade, they know very well how to manage themselves, how to protect themselves. They will be prepared only for this.
That's a, sir, that's an extraordinary claim you've made. Just look at the numbers we just pointed out. Since 2015, there have been 115 attacks by cow vigilantes in which 46 people have been killed, 146 injured. These are all people who are not vigilantes, who have been killed and injured.
What we have seen in the state of Karnataka, the cow vigilantes have lost their life. It is not the people who are in the trade.
Right.
In not even one incident in the state of Karnataka we have seen where the people who are into this illegal trade have been affected. It is only the people who are the cow vigilant, they have lost their life. They have been affected. In the state of Karnataka, this is what we have seen. I can provide that data, the information regarding this.
News from Maharashtra now. The state has proposed the death penalty for crimes against women. A bill called Shakti proposed the death penalty for rape. Investigation period for crimes against women will be 15 working days, down from the current 2 months. Here's a report.
Now, death penalty for rape, part of a stringent new Maharashtra government bill to tackle crimes against women that will be presented before the state assembly on Monday. The bill called Shakti proposes the death penalty for rape instead of a current prison terms, a move similar to an Andhra Pradesh legislation earlier this year. Any person convicted for an acid attack will have to pay 10 lakh rupees for the survivor's rehabilitation. Investigation periods for crime against women will be 15 working days, down from the current 2 months.
आणि चर्चा झाल्यानंतर जर विधानसभेने जर त्याला मंजुरी दिली तर हा केंद्र शासनाकडे शेवटी मंजुरीला जाईल राष्ट्रपतीकडे मंजुरीला जाईल.
But activists in Maharashtra say they are not convinced with the death for rapist argument.
We have seen what happened in Hyderabad. Out of emotional outrage, those boys were killed, they were shot. We have seen the brutal, very recent brutal rape of Hathras, what happened there. Yes, that was a little different case, but somewhere, like, you know, death has to be there, some kind of a vengeance has to be there, some kind of a revenge has to be there, some kind of a showing it to the society, look, this is the way we should react to this kind of a heinous crime. Yes, but death penalty will never be able to control rape.
With this bill, a step in the right direction is taken, but a strong bill alone won't be a deterrent. What also needs to be changed is the mindset of the society and how it looks at its women and children. In Mumbai with camera person Praveen Rohit, this is Purva Chitnis for NDTV.
Time now for a break. On the other side, we'll get you all the international news. And UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson has said there's a strong possibility that Brexit talks will fail. Welcome back. International news. And President-elect Joe Biden will nominate Dennis McDonough, a former chief of staff to President Barack Obama, to lead the Department of Veterans Affairs. And he has picked Susan E. Rice, Obama's former national security advisor, to run the White House Domestic Policy Council. She She tweeted, I'm humbled and excited by this call to serve. The scale of challenges ahead demands a government that works for all Americans. We must restore trust in government through strong and equitable domestic policy that builds a better back home to go.